Carsten, I warmly welcome you to be here on our stage for the press conference regarding why Europe needs a Green New Deal. So, and now I pass over to Svetko, which will introduce us to the topic. Thank you.
Vielen Dank. Ich freue mich, dass I'll speak English, but just at the beginning I will say something in German. So, es freut mich sehr, dass wir heute hier sind, und es freut mich noch mehr, dass Pamela mit uns hier ist. Es wird heute kurz sein, aber nicht so wie kurz bei Trump. Eigentlich haben wir eine Stunde. Kurz is the name of the Chancellor of Austria, which means short in English. Okay. So I said it would be short, but not short as Kurz was at Trump, which was very short. So I will speak in English. It's a sunny day. So let me start by a joke. The joke is about an old man who goes to a doctor, and the doctor says, I have good news and I have bad news. The good news is you have cancer, and the bad news is you have Alzheimer. But as soon as you come home, you will forget about the cancer. And couldn't we say the same? The good news is that it's sun outside and that it's hot in February, unlike the last Elevate when it was snow. But the bad news is that this is actually an effect of climate change. So we are here today to speak about the necessity of a Green New Deal in Europe. Only a few days ago, the richest person, the third richest person on planet Earth, with a net worth of $85 billion, in his annual shareholders letter, he warned about the prospect of a mega catastrophe. Although such a disaster could happen tomorrow or decades from now, one thing is sure, he said, the catastrophe is inevitable. Of course, Warren Buffett, who was the author of this, otherwise he wouldn't be the third richest person in the world, already has an answer for such an outcome. He says, I'm quoting, this is just a letter which was published a few days ago. He said, when such a mega catastrophe strikes, we will get our share of the losses and they will be big, very big. This hardly comes as a surprise from someone who is remembered for saying there's a class war, but it's my class, the rich class, that is making the war and we are winning. What we have today is not just a class war. What we have today is a war on our children. It's a war on our climate. It's a war on our future. And it is precisely the class represented by Warren Buffett and others who was in the first place responsible for the inevitable catastrophe. We are here today not because we like to be activists. Okay, we like it as well, but because it is necessary if we want to have a future at all. Obviously, what we are facing today with climate change and a total environmental breakdown is the biggest threat humanity and the planet itself has ever faced. We are here today to say that Europe needs a Green New Deal before it's too late. And why does Europe need a Green New Deal? If you take just three recent examples, and Pamela has spoken about it a lot as well, this is one of the reasons why she is here with us, it can be shown clearly. The first case is the Gilets Jaunes in France. The second case, an example, is Energiewende in Germany and the most developed countries in the European Union. And the third, but not last, is the big children's protests and school strikes, which are happening all over the world at the moment, and they will happen in Graz as well on Friday. If you connect all these three events, if you are worried as we are, you will come to the conclusion to which we came, that the only solution to Europe is nothing more, nothing less, but a Green New Deal. First, as we could have seen with the Yellow Vests in France, the green transition cannot be paid by the poor. And the solution isn't just a Macronian simple carbon tax. Climate change cannot be solved by taxation. In the near future, we will probably have similar and even bigger movements like the Yellow Vests, so we better respond to them now. Second, as the case of diesel cars shows, instead of outsourcing air pollution to countries of the periphery of the European Union, or even Austria. You might perhaps know that Austria is the second in Europe after Italy when it comes to the import of the diesel cars. Instead of that, we need a pan-European solution. I just flew in from Belgrade. If you go to Belgrade, it was a few days ago the most polluted city in the world. So it's not Beijing, it's not New Delhi, it was Belgrade. And it is connected to the export of diesel cars. Not directly, but it is. And third, what you can see with the children's protests taking place all across Europe, even in Austria, there might soon be no future, even if there is sun outside, if you don't come up with a solution for the 21st century using the technology and institutions which we already have in place. This is why we think that Europe urgently needs a Green New Deal, a massive program of investment in green technology, which would be linked to a jobs guarantee all across Europe. When Greta, the Swedish girl who inspired the school strikes, last week in Brussels confronted the European establishment, unlike Theresa May, who said that children are wasting valuable school time, and unlike Angela Merkel, who even blamed the Russians and said that children couldn't come to such an idea without an outside influence, Jean-Claude Juncker responded that we need billions of spending on climate change in the next 7 years. Unlike that, DiEM25 and Dine Europa, we propose 500 billions of euros per year, which means annually, of massive investment into green technology and clean energy. Why? Because without investment, Europe can't achieve its climate goals. How would, and I'm finishing soon, how would the Green New Deal function? Where would the money come from? This is, of course, a question. What we are proposing is that the European Investment Bank should issue bonds up to 500 billion euros every year for 5 years in order to finance projects for green energy, green transport, green agriculture, and green industry throughout Europe. At the same time, the European Central Bank should announce that it will stand by to protect the European Investment Bank by buying its bonds if speculation forces down prices. Something similar, just using the American institutions like the Fed, is currently being proposed by the Democrats around Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez. But honestly speaking, even if it seems that the Green New Deal is something rather new, the Green New Deal existed among the indigenous communities for thousands of years. So if the green in the new Green New Deal means that we need a new deal for the 21st century, similar to the New Deal of Roosevelt, only green, then the new in the Green New Deal means that we have the technology already at hand to make it happen. To end, the catastrophe might be inevitable. Even the top rich, like Warren Buffett agree, but instead of calculating the profits of the self-destruction of humanity, we should do all we can in order to make the impossible possible, namely to have a future at all in Europe today. Thanks a lot, and I'm passing the word to Daniela Plač.
Thank you, Srećko, for this. And ich danke Ihnen fürs Zuhören und würde jetzt gleich weitergeben an Daniela, die hier auch noch ihre Perspektive beitragen möchte. Daniela.
Danke. Hallo, mein Name ist Dani Platsch. Ich bin als Österreicherin geboren. Ich bin als Deutsche aufgewachsen. Und dank meiner slowakischen Mutter bin ich zur Europäerin erzogen. Und deshalb bin ich auch hier. Ich bin eines dieser Millionen europäischen Gesichter, denen Sie jeden Tag begegnen. Auf der Straße, in der Arbeit, hier im Raum. Wir sind überall. Und laut aktuellen Umfragen wissen auch 90% von uns bereits, dass wir uns in einer globalen Klimakrise befinden. Mehr als 90% in jedem einzelnen europäischen Land. Wir verstehen auch, dass unser Lebensstil fruchtbaren Boden vernichtet, Artensterben verursacht, die Ozeane vergiftet und wie nebenbei eine globale Ungleichheit schafft, die Millionen Menschen auf der Welt ins Elend reißt. Ich sage das hier nur so klar, weil ich nicht will, dass später irgendwer wieder sagen kann, wir haben das damals nicht gewusst. Ja, wir wissen es. Und wir wissen auch, was das Problem dahinter ist. Es ist ganz einfach. Es ist so einfach, dass es mir letztens ein kleines Future for Fridays Mädchen erklärt hat. Und weil ich es nicht besser sagen kann als Sie, möchte ich Sie hier zitieren. Sie sagt, die meisten Menschen sind echt okay und leben einfach ihr Leben. Aber es gibt auch welche, die für Geld ihre Oma verkaufen. Und das sind die, die uns jetzt auch unsere Zukunft stehlen. Da muss die Politik was tun. Sie hat recht. Fakt ist, 71% aller globalen Treibhausgase der letzten 30 Jahre wurden insgesamt von weniger als 100 fossilen Konzernen verursacht. Ich bin froh, dass Kinder heute mit der Wahrheit aufwachsen. Als ich noch jung war, wurde mir erklärt, dass es mein Haarspray ist, der das alles verursacht. Aber nein, es sind 100 globale Konzerne. Ich finde es gut, wenn wir uns alle für unseren Planeten und für unser Klima verantwortlich fühlen. Aber ich möchte, dass wir aufhören, so zu tun, als ob es darum geht, was jeder Einzelne und wie viel jeder Einzelne von uns tut. Im Gegenteil, wir haben die Verantwortung, jetzt gemeinsam und kollektiv zu handeln. Wir müssen uns von diesen 100 fossilen Konzernen befreien, indem wir sie überflüssig machen. Und genau darum geht es im Green New Deal. Der Green New Deal kombiniert unser Streben nach Befreiung und Demokratie mit einem radikalen Umbau unserer Wirtschaft und einer universellen Jobgarantie, also dem Recht auf einen anständigen Job mit anständiger Bezahlung und das für jeden Menschen, der das will. Am 26. Mai werden wir diesen Green New Deal bei der Europawahl in 8 Ländern gemeinsam zur Wahl stellen. Ich kandidiere gemeinsam mit Yannis Varoufakis und Sreczko auf der Liste in Deutschland. In Deutschland, weil es egal sein sollte, wo wir herkommen und wo wir in Europa leben. Aber auch in Deutschland, weil ich aus Österreich komme und weil ich weiß, zu was Menschen fähig sind. Österreich hat der Welt bereits 2 Weltkriege beschert. Unsere Regierung unter Sebastian Kurz mobilisiert jetzt gerade in ganz Europa für eine neue Rassentrennung. Ich denke, es ist Zeit, dass wir anderen, die Gutmenschen, uns darum kümmern, gemeinsam mit anderen Europäerinnen für Demokratie in Europa zu kämpfen.
Vielen lieben Dank, Dani Platsch, für diese Ausführungen aus der internen Sicht als in Österreich lebende Kandidatin für die deutsche Wahlliste. Last but not least, our star guest from Canada, actually living in France, so she has many things to say because she knows the American, the Canadian, also the German, the French situation, and she's a political activist. And so I'm very interested in your perspective and why are you supporting the Green New Deal?
Well, it seems a little surreal that I'm even here sitting with Sreczko and Daniel because I've been an activist for a very long time, and it's kind of transformed over my lifetime. I was just an animal activist when I was young, and I always kind of collected the misfits and became the person that everyone brought the bird with the broken wing to, and I just kind of ended up being that person. And raised on Vancouver Island, I was very conscientious of nature, of the ocean, and just really my father taught me to respect nature, but he was a hunter. And I ended up finding a dead deer hanging upside down with no head dripping into a bucket of blood. And that's when I realized that was meat and I didn't want to eat that anymore. So for compassionate reasons, I became vegetarian and I realized that one of the best things you can do for the environment is to be vegan. But this is something I learned over the course of my lifetime, and everything I learn, I apply to my life. And I've just met such great, interesting people over my lifetime, in Julian Assange, people, Giannis, people that are, I don't have a degree. I don't have a lot of formal education, but just maybe a little bit of street awareness, or just to be engaged in the world, a lover of art. I think artists are the freedom fighters of the world, and to be engaged in the world is sexy. I think being an activist is sexy, and I want to create that image. I have a new offshoot of my foundation. It's called Tenure. It's based on academic tenure, where we choose 10 activists a year and we pay their salaries for 10 years. And this way people can be career activists and not have to, work at McDonald's to pay their family's bills, or have some kind of small job to continue the fight. And so I want to be able to support people that are going to be an activist no matter what. And I think there's a lot of people in the world that want to help. And I think you're an activist if you read a book, if you go to a museum, if you are interested in anything other than yourself, in an age where empathy is lacking and things are so complicated and we have so much access to so much information, that I want to be able to use my platform, whatever that is, however that came about, and when I find something interesting and something important, I want to be able to put myself out there. I want to be able to reach out to people and learn. I'm here to learn. I'm here to meet everybody and find out what else I can do. You know, I've been tweeting a lot lately because I keep thinking, God, it's too late. It's too late. We have to, every time we learn something, we have to share it, and we have to be very passionate about what we believe in, and you know, to make a difference and not be politically correct and just say how you feel and open conversations. And this is how I teach my sons to be. So this is how I have to be. And this is how I encourage my friends and my, you know, everybody I meet, is just to learn. And you know, I'm very concerned still about Julian Assange. We don't want to forget about him. He's in a dire position, and you know, Switzerland just offered him
Geneva
asylum. And you know, what is Austria doing? So we want to keep on asking these questions. A Green New Deal sounds great to me. I think an alternative to anything that's going on right now is important. And I need to educate myself more about exactly everything. But everything I learn, I try to discuss in open conversations. So this is why I'm here, you know, here in Elevate. This is my first festival, and I want to go to a lot of them. And I think I really want to learn how to speak from the heart. I don't want to... I've done things before where I've really been strict and read, you know, a script, and I thought, you know, maybe there's something else I can share, and another way I can communicate, because you know, I have friends who are extremely intellectual and they are so frustrated about not being able to reach people. And you know, for instance, Vivian Westwood, who I love, who is a dear friend of mine, you know, and she is always frustrated with not being able to communicate, and she always told me, Pamela, just be yourself and just get out there, and you have your role to play. So hopefully I'm helping, and I know for a fact the work I've done with PETA, we've created animal welfare laws where there were none before, and it's you know, people are stopping to produce fur in fashion, and you know, there's all sorts of new fabrics that are made from recyclable, you know, plastic from the ocean. So there are solutions, and we need unique thinkers. So I'm encouraging people to think differently, behave differently, reach inside somewhere, and maybe it's not from school or from anywhere else, just we need new ideas. And so I'm very excited about this, and I'm so excited to see all these children coming out, because they are speaking the truth. They're smarter than anybody I've seen so far, and so I'm really proud of that. And so I'm here to encourage freedom of speech and just really gut feelings, not something that maybe that you're, I don't know, just we need a new way of thinking. So I'm excited about this. I'm excited about Deem. I'm happy to be in Graz, and you know, so whatever I can do to help, I want to do.
That's so very thank you. So great to have you here, yeah, and supporting this. So, my dear journalist, ich switch wieder nach Deutsch. Wir haben jetzt folgenden Vorschlag. Wir können jetzt Fragen stellen. Sie können Fragen stellen an unsere Podiumsgäste. Ich würde Sie bitten, per Handzeichen anzumelden, wenn Sie sprechen möchten. Dann komme ich mit dem Mikro zu Ihnen. Ich behalte das Mikro in der Hand. Sie können reinsprechen und sagen am besten, von welchem Medium Sie kommen, den Namen und mit wem Sie die Frage, wem Sie die Frage stellen möchten. Ist das fein soweit? Everything you understand? So they will question the answers then.
Okay. Yep. Okay. Thank you. Why is it so warm in Graz? I thought it was snowing last year.
Yeah, climate
right?
change.
Climate change.
Yeah. Or Elevate organized it, I don't know.
Yeah. You need to bring a sweatshirt.
Hi, nice to have you here. The Elevate Festival is also about music,
yes.
And there's a whole program about it. So what kind of acts are you looking for, or have you had a look at it? And the second question, or question to add, how was your musical socialization? How did you, with what kind of music did you grow up?
Me?
That's yeah.
Okay. Well, my son's a musician, Dylan. Okay. He has a band called Midnight Kids, and it's a little bit electronic. It's very cool. I'm so impressed with him. So I love his music. Well, music and art and politics, it all goes together because this is a way to reach people in places where you're not necessarily preaching to the choir. You know, you need to put yourself in situations where everybody's it's creative. It starts, I think this movement has to be creative, you know, and it has to, it's poetic, it's a romantic struggle, it's like music. So it's, we have to create a song, we have to figure out how to move forward, and it's really going to come from somewhere else, not necessarily an encyclopedia or a school book, you know, it's going to have to come from the heart.
Next question.
What kind of music did you grow up with? What kind of pop culture?
Oh, my, Elvis. My mother is an Elvis fanatic. And rock and roll. I like the blues myself. Like I said, my son's a musician. It's been around me. I'm enjoying it. I'm looking forward to seeing something tonight.
Next question.
Next question.
Please raise your hand and Claudia will bring the mic. Yep.
Hallo, mein Name ist Eva Foramiti. Ich bin hier für Graz ungeschminkt. The first question I will put in English. How do you see the connection between meat consumption and climate change?
Oh, well, I think global warming is, factory farming is a leading cause of global warming. And meat consumption isn't just, it's a lot of waste. There's also the refrigeration, there's the transport. If you go back, how much water does it take to make a pound of beef? I mean, meat is really a huge issue when it comes to climate change. So, like I said, even eating less meat is great. I'm not here to tell everyone to go vegan. You know, cold, but just do the best you can. I'd prefer to be in that position to encourage people to do better instead of be so, you know, black and white.
Next target. Next questions. There is a question in the front. There is a question in the front.
I wanted to ask about the festival. Who told you first about Elevate Festival and what did it tell you?
Sreko invited me to the festival. We've been talking a lot. We've been friends for a while now. We met.
Actually, I think Daniel invited you, but then
Daniel invited.
But then you told me that you got this invitation for a festival, and then I said you must do it. I think that it was
okay,
like.
Okay, Okay, Daniel.
But it's also, I would say, it's also a product of collaboration. Pamela and me have already for quite some months exchanging ideas, discussing things and so on. So I would say it's a natural, logical step that we are now here, that we will also meet other activists at the festival. Mm-hmm. We are together at the opening of the festival. Unfortunately, it's too kurz, too short. But
yeah, we could both talk all day.
Oh. A question in the back.
My name is Leo. I'm involved here in the house and freelancing for Neues Deutschland. My question would be maybe to Sreczko and Pamela. When you've been talking about the Green New Deal, and for sure, as you said, every alternative to the policies that are happening nowadays are just great, and we have to welcome them. But maybe it's a very long discussion, but to make it short, isn't it too late somehow? You know, you were talking also about the catastrophe that is going on and the situation we are living now and we are in now. And don't we need something much, much more radical, something that is a real rupture to the system we live in?
Mm-hmm. Shall I?
Well, yeah, you go ahead. Yeah, you go ahead. Of course it's too late. That's why we have to go crazy and do everything we can and gather as many people and do as many festivals and you know, not just talk and do things individually, do things, you know, push our governments and do what the Gilets Jaunes are doing, just get out on the streets and we really have to activate because it is too late. But we have to make it better for our children. And this is why people like DiEM and these new deals and government things are really important, because they have to work hand in hand.
Yeah, if I may respond as well. Yeah, it might be too late, but I think what we have to do is really to create something what seems impossible today, which would be a sort of planetary democracy, if you want, based on green energy and a green transition. What is happening at these days, you know, we are not alone. I mean, this is a proof that we are not alone. You know, at this table, you have an Austrian, you have someone who was born in a country which doesn't exist anymore. So I'm Croatian, but I live everywhere. There is a Canadian who lives in France. I'm a philosopher. She's an actress. We are all different, you know, we come from different wakes of life, but we are here in Graz, in Austria today. At the same time, there is a Green New Deal being advocated in the United States. It became very popular, at least there is a big discussion about it. At the same time, there are the children's strikes all over the world. I put a lot of hope into them. But to quote a French philosopher, Maurice Blanchot, the apocalypse is disappointing. And why is the apocalypse disappointing? This is what Blanchot said, because we didn't succeed to create something which we are going to lose. And only by creating this something which we are going to lose, and this is a true global community based on a Green New Deal, we would be able to prevent the apocalypse. And I think this is the good point, that today we have to do our best, even if it's too late already. If we don't do anything, we maybe have a decade or two. If we do something, we might have a few decades more. But I think we should also go in the direction in which the Silicon Valley gurus are going. I don't know if you saw recently what Jeff Bezos, the richest person in the world, the owner of Amazon, at a private talk in New York, said. He was dreaming about space exploration and how we'll outsource industry to the space and so on. And, you know, you might think whatever you think about this plan. I think, of course, that he should pay taxes and use the taxes for a Green New Deal. And instead of going into the space or the Mars, to invest as much as possible to preserve the planet. But I think also at the same time, and that's why we are here, and that's why we need Pamela, I would say, we need imagination, dreams, and emotions. And this is Pamela, what she's doing the best, I would say, because she's honest. And if we have dreams, imagination, and hope, I think hope is the crucial concept of the 21st century, we need something what the Silicon Valley gurus are saying. You know, they are imagining space exploration and so on. Where did the utopian thinking of the progressive disappear? I think what we are trying to do here, even if it's too late, to offer such a vision, you know, and it's not just a green dream. You will have a problem in the United States now that 3.5 million truck drivers will lose their jobs. What will you do then? Of course, some there in the Silicon Valley are proposing the universal basic income. What we are proposing at DiEM25 and Dai in Europa, Democratia in Europa, is a universal basic dividend. So if we have the technological means already at hand, which means that we could have full automation, artificial intelligence, smart trucks, smart boats and everything, what will the people do? And then you need to find a mechanism from technology from which the people could make a living and not just be consumers and Amazon will send, you know, books from Mars to Earth, which will be uninhabitable.
Right.
Okay.
Yes.
Thanks.
Hi, I'm Elvis and I came from Italy and I'm a philosopher too. But since I'm a philosopher, I would like to make you this question, because some months ago, so I have also, I always had a kind of a humanistic approach to culture and to life and to journalism, until some months ago, where I did a professional course of environmental journalism, mm-hmm. Very interesting, and the professor was almost scientist of chemics, physics, at the Polytechnic of Milan, most of them. And what I found really interesting was the fact that, I mean, I really learned a lot of new things that I didn't know. First of all, that the scientists, the community of scientists, are completely agree with most of the topics. So it's not just a matter of values or defend the right party or the left party, but it's a matter of science and of ethical journalism, you know what I mean? Because in Italy, I read a lot of newspapers and there are a lot of fake news about the environment that are completely ideology. Mm-hmm. And there is nothing scientific in some news. There are really absurd things. And so what I want to ask you is also I'm a member of DiEM25, which is the role of science that the party and you as one of the main mind of the party, are you going to give to the movement, which is so the role you're going to give to science, and what do you think is necessary to do to fight fake news about climate change and environment issues in general? Is it clear, my question?
It's clear. Let me, if I may, just very short respond also in a philosophical way, if you, you may allow me. You know Alice in Wonderland. And in Alice in Wonderland, you have a beautiful dialogue between Alice and Humpty Dumpty, when Alice asks Humpty Dumpty, how can you make that words have so many meanings? And you know what Humpty Dumpty answers? He says, it's only the question, who is the master, and that's all. Like the point was that the one who is in power imposes meaning, and that you can see as well with Donald Trump, with Bolsonaro in Brazil, with Sebastian Kurz, if you want, in Austria. And so I think it's really, it's wrong to think that these people are climate deniers. And this is this you will hear all the time. These people are denying, you can see the sun outside, blah, blah, blah. How can you speak about climate change? They are not denying it. Warren Buffett, whom I quoted, he's very well aware that capitalist economy is leading in that direction, that we will have no earth. So my quick answer to you is we need to take political power, whether it means running for the European Parliament, some random people like us, you know, I never imagined to run for the European Parliament. I don't even want to end up there, to be honest. I would be happiest to be at a Croatian island and write books. But unfortunately, the sea levels will rise. So in 20 or 30 years, there will be no islands. My islands in Croatia are already full of garbage. I cannot solve it. The local community cannot solve it. We need a pan-European global response to it. And that's why I'm active, for instance. Regarding scientists, we need them more than ever. They were drafting the program of the European Spring, which is the coalition which we are running for the European elections and so on. But we also need, that's why I mentioned the indigenous knowledge, if you want. The indigenous knowledge, I think, is crucial. In what way, what Pamela already said, what is, you know, I'm also vegetarian for 20 years, and I think I never mentioned it publicly until now, but I think now is the time to become vegetarian, vegan, because it is connected, because the way you treat animals, the way you treat other people, the way you treat nature is the way, what kind of world will we have. So in this sense, yes, we need scientists, we need indigenous knowledge, we need local communities, cooperatives, municipalism, bioregionalism. I think bioregionalism is a crucial term in order to resist. But we also shouldn't be ashamed, or we shouldn't be scared to go for the biggest institutions in the world. If I may add something which might sound megalomaniac, but you can read the article by Yanis Varoufakis and David Adler in The Guardian, which is our proposition to radically transform the International Monetary Fund and the World Bank, which would actually help funding the European, the Green New Deal globally. And I think we need such bold ideas. If they will, you know, become reality, I don't know. We are doing our best. But if we were not today here or not doing our best, to be honest, I wouldn't have a reason to wake up. There in the audience is my nephew, who is 3 years old. And I don't have a child. Pamela has children. Mikhail is 3 years old. What will the world look like in 3 decades when he will be of the age of me or a bit younger? You know, this is something which really concerns all of us, and I think we should do our best.
Okay, sorry. Yeah, Andreas Müller here for the daily newspaper Der Standard. This is a question for Ms. Anderson. Mm-hmm. You tweeted lately, Kurz is proud to have closed the Balkan route, and I'm proud to be coming to Austria next week and to show that this is not an answer to Europe's deep problems. What do you want to tell our, or the Chancellor of Austria, if he was listening right now?
You know, I'm just obviously very concerned about the refugee crisis all over the world, and there's so many, you know, so many reasons why we're in this position. We're all going to be climate refugees at some point, so we have to consider how we treat these people that are coming from places of war that, you know, they didn't start, and, you know, the meddling of U.S. and just there's so many elements to it, and I just think the human, human to human, to see these people, suffering and not being able to start new lives and to shut down things and build walls is just not the answer. It's not the human. It's not humane, and it's just ridiculous. So I'm trying to I help everywhere I can at different refugee centers and in Calais a lot, and I speak to people and I speak to children, and I just can't imagine that this is just spoken so lightly about in the press, and when you really meet people, how could you shut down any way of people to kind of have a better life? So it's just discouraging to see people in power do this.
Perfect.
Thanks.
I have two questions left, and if anybody else has some questions, please give me a sign. Otherwise, we would finish the press conference in about 5 minutes, so that would be great. So,
Hi, my name is Harold. I have a very short question. I like the ideas of your movement. I think it's not a party, it's a movement. That's how I see it. So the crucial thing will be, maybe that's a question for Dani, but maybe also for Pamela later to add, how are you going to motivate the people to vote for you? I mean, that's the thing. Are you going to make a TV series, or is there something in the line? How are you going to get the people to vote for you?
How do we get the people to vote for us? Obviously, in April and May, there will be huge campaigns and millions of euros spent all across Europe to motivate people to put their cross in the respective box. This is what most parties in Europe do. We don't have money. We only have people. We have us. And this is what we want to show. We want to show people we are one of us. We all the same, no? This is about Europe and the people of Europe. And what you see is what you get. We are not the perfect people. We are the misfits, as you said. Yeah. But we're trying, and I think it's time for us to stand up. As I said earlier, I think 90% of the European population thinks in a similar way. The only thing that keeps us all from standing up and like why we're not more people in the front and in front of the cameras is because it's scary to speak up in Europe at the moment. People are afraid.
So we're encouraging people to be brave and to do something different, not be part of the bewildered herd and not do what your parents told you and everything else. I mean, just, you know, question authority, question what you've been taught your whole life, because we're in a different time now and we need unique thinkers. And so to take a chance, I mean, you vote for somebody and they're institutionalized in 50 days. They're not the person that you voted for. So you really have to vote for a movement. You have to do something that you've never done before, because it hasn't worked. And look what's happened to the planet, and people they talk a lot. And I think it'd be a really bold, sexy move to vote for somebody completely just wild. And that's what we have to do.
Perfect. So there's one point.
I would vote for Pamela if she was running.
I wouldn't.
For the Austrian chancellor or head of European Commission. I think you would do a much better job than the guys in power now.
We have more fun.
And it would be much more fun.
And what I forgot is the questions from the Facebook Live. So we can do that afterwards, after this question. Okay, fine.
Yes, my question also goes to Pamela Anderson. With all your being an advocate for PETA, for WikiLeaks, for now DiEM25, how do you integrate all your activism in your professional life? So have you come across barriers, like not being a vegan, not wearing fur? Have there been jobs or films you had to turn down, or people saying,
I'm a little high maintenance, yeah. So now I have my little narrow road that I can go down, because I don't think I'm that welcome in Hollywood circles, or, you know, a lot of things are tested on animals, so I won't work for different companies, and I try to have as much integrity as I can. I call myself a naughty vegan because I'm in France. It's difficult. difficult. So I do the best I can, and I encourage people to do the best they can. But yeah, it's not about money. And if I had to make money and not have integrity, then I wouldn't. I don't care. I don't need it. I don't need. I'd rather stick to at least apply what I learned to my life. And that's what I, you know, that's what I do. And I really enjoy this. I mean, but I know I have a lot of diverse causes, but it really all goes together. You know, starting with PETA and the environmental issues, and you know, trying to save the rainforest, and working with people, and doing vegan bags, and you know, and vegan makeup, and cruelty-free this, and we can do it. It's easy. The choices are there. And 20 years ago, everybody thought I was crazy because I wanted to make bottles out of corn, you know, for hair products, and now it's in fashion. So it's, you know, Givenchy is no more fur. And you know, everyone's always excited to tell me when I see these big designers, they run up to me and they say, we're doing it. We're finally doing it. I'm like, oh, thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. I know I sounded crazy a long time ago, but it's in fashion to have compassion. And
you come from the future, I would say, because you already had the ideas, you know.
I had the ideas. I'm always ahead of my time. I don't know how to monetize it. I'm really bad with all that, but everyone says, but I'd rather be a pioneer, and I'd rather just, you know, like I said, be brave and do things differently than everybody else. That makes an interesting life, and it keeps you young.
Perfect. It does. Okay, I think one last question, right, from the Facebook
from
Live.
Facebook Live, yeah.
Okay. And hello to everyone who is watching us.
So we got one really interesting question I'm also very interested in. So how did you get to know each other, Srechko and Pam?
I would say
steamy night in Berlin.
We met in Berlin. What did you say?
It was a steamy night in Berlin.
A steamy night.
I was trying to be the interview.
Yeah, but I would say the answer is actually Julian Assange.
It was Julian Assange. Yeah.
It's our common friend who basically put us in touch. And since we cannot meet Julian, or we can meet him at the Ecuadorian embassy, but it's pretty tough at the moment, then we are trying to do together the best we can. And then when we met in Berlin, we stayed in touch. And this is actually only the second time we meet.
Yeah. Perfect. And Srechko, this is for you. Would you have imagined 10 or 20 years ago, you joined forces with Pamela Anderson?
Well, 20 years ago, I was, 16, I think. I was not anymore. But when I was watching Baywatch, perhaps at that time I could imagine running on a beautiful Californian beach with Pamela. But to be honest, I would never imagine that we would be here today. Graz is a city where me and my parents came when Yugoslavia collapsed and Croatia was in a war. It was the only place where you could get H&M and these products and so on. I know it might sound as a contradiction. And at that time, when in the 90s we were watching Baywatch, which was a kind of, you know, dream for us, although now today we know that US and California have plenty of problems, but can you imagine a country during war where you can see all these pictures? We didn't know yet that the end of history would never happen. You know, this Fukuyama's point that liberal democracy will be the end of the story and so on. And that basically, you know, this dream was fake. That not everyone in the world can lead a first world lifestyle. There are scientists who are saying that if everyone on the globe today would lead a first world lifestyle, that we would need seven planets similar to planet Earth to lead such a lifestyle. So no, I wouldn't imagine it, but who knows what will happen in 1 year or in 5 years, maybe something even beyond our wildest imagination.
Hope.
Yeah, that's it.
Positively.
We have, together with Yanis Varoufakis, you founded DiEM25 2016. 3 years later, you are on the ballot for the EU elections in Germany. Tell us more about your aspirations. We will see you as a European parliamentarian this year. answered it.
Only if Pamela comes to the European Parliament as well to give a speech.
Perfect.
Yeah, but I think we should slowly.
Yeah.
Finish, yeah, because we
if
have.
If there is no more question, I would.
If there is a question from a journalist, please go ahead for a last question. If not,
one more,
please. Yeah, one more, and
so
then we finish.
Yep.
Because we are.
On and a everybody tight schedule. Else can send me an email if you have any more further questions. So.
Thank you very much. That's my
the last question, I think. So Pamela, you said it's not 5 to 12, it's 12 already. It might be already too late already, and still you don't tell people to go vegan. So I'm still thinking about this, and I partly agree. But how can it be not our moral obligation as a human to be a voice for those who are screaming for their lives outside in the slaughterhouses? And how can we as persons put much pressure on those who are responsible and to finally reach that the case for animal rights will come on the political agenda?
Well, I have a lot of activist friends who are very extreme, and I find that they have their role to play and I have mine, and I feel that I get a lot further if I can talk to people about lifestyle and about improving their lifestyle or changing their lifestyle for health reasons, for compassionate reasons, for all sorts of reasons. Because sometimes when you just, you know, drive it down their throats that that's the end of the world, they don't want to listen. They put their fingers in their ears and they don't do anything. So I think it's important to encourage people positively and be grateful for the small changes and hope for the big changes. But yes, of course, to be vegan is important, and it's very important to me. But some other people may, you know, try to reduce the amount of meat that they eat, or you know, use less plastic, or there's all sorts of things you can do. So we all have to, as a collective, a community, we can do better. But I'm not going to dismiss somebody who's trying, you know, but I'm going to encourage people to do the best they can, and to educate themselves, because people don't necessarily, you know, what do I know? I mean, I've educated myself, I've made my own personal decisions, and I've talked to my own children about that, but I don't think a lot of people want to listen to me sometimes about what's the best thing to do for them. So I just encourage people to find out for themselves. And it's proven that the meat industry is terrible for the environment. So, and there's so many other things. We have to do so many things, and it's going to take sacrifice and create different habits, and it's going to take a lot of work.
Thank you. Vielen lieben Dank nochmal, dass Sie alle hier gewesen sind. Wenn Sie noch mehr hören möchten, heute Abend spricht Pamela und Sreczko auch noch auf dem Eröffnungsevent vom Elevate Festival. Und wir danken auf jeden Fall ganz herzlich den Machern vom Elevate, dass wir hier sein dürfen, dass wir die Räumlichkeiten nutzen dürfen und ja, alles so toll organisiert hat. Ich freue mich schon auf das Festival heute Abend. Das wird ganz wundervoll werden. Wenn jemand noch Fragen hat, kann er sich gerne jetzt im Anschluss noch an mich wenden. Ich bin die Pressesprecherin von dem deutschen Wahlflügel von DiEM25, Demokratie in Europa. Ich habe Visitenkarten hier. Wir haben eine Website, auf der können Sie unser Programm nachlesen, www.deineuropa.jetzt. Und ansonsten, ja, sage ich einfach vielen, vielen lieben herzlichen Dank fürs Kommen und hoffe, wir sehen uns bei der nächsten Gelegenheit bald wieder.
Okay. Oh. So the first step is done. Step one, check. Okay, we did it.